welcome back to the Liminal Lounge. I hope you're all good and well. Today, I'm really chuffed to welcome the wonderful Mark Leckey to come and join us. Hello, Mark. How's it going?
Hello, everyone. Hello, Beck. Yeah, all good.
Before we get going, I know that lots of people are new to the Liminal Lounge, so I just want to give you a quick heads up as to how we roll here. This isn't a podcast in kind of traditional sense. There's no set questions. Neither myself nor Mark have any idea where this conversation is going to take us. It makes life a whole lot less stressful for my neurodivergent noodle. And hopefully it's the same for Mark too. It also allows us the opportunity to explore avenues that would be closed to us if we were following a strict set of questions. So okay, that's the boring bit over with. Oh, and apologies if I sound really snuffly at the minute. I have got a really bad case of hay fever. So if you hear little grunts and things, it's nothing odd. It's just me fighting with the pollen. Now, for anyone who isn't aware of Mark and his work, here's a very brief overview. Mark is a highly influential mixed media contemporary artist whose work resonates deeply with myself and inspires my liminal world's research immensely. From the last years of the 20th century, he has created works which explore ideas of nostalgia, childhood and young adulthood, and class, where ghosts can be found not only within physical landscapes, but also within the digital, reaching out to us via still and moving images, where screens become summoning boards and mark a form of medium. But alongside these elements, Mark also brings folklore and the prehistoric past into the present. Like myself, I see him as looking at modern landscapes through a Neolithic lens and vice versa, inviting people into a world where concrete structures merge into Neolithic long barrows, fairy folk lurk beneath motorway flyovers, exchanging their silken clothing for tracksuits and trainers, reaching out to beguile and entrance wanderers, and where rites of passage are undertaken at bus stops, amongst many other places. As those of you who follow the Liminal Worlds project, but the future ghost element in particular, know, you'll often hear me discuss how we are all ghosts in the making. For me, Mark's work channels this kind of thinking deeply. And as I said just now, he really is a huge influence on the Lim Worlds project. Mark's creations have been shown across the world, and both Britain's Tate Galleries and the Centre Pompidou in Paris contain his works within their permanent collections. Having won the Turner Prize in 2008 for Industrial Light and Magic, Mark's most recent work, a virtual reality re-exploration, I would say, of the bridge at London's Swedenborg House this spring, brings past, present, and perhaps potential futures together beautifully in an 8-minute metaphysical deep dive, which we shall ponder upon shortly, hopefully. So, Mark, hello. Thank you so much for taking the time to join us. Really appreciate it. You certainly have packed a lot in over the past 30 years.
Well, I had a slow start. I didn't really start making things till I was in my late 30s, early 40s. So, yeah, before that, I just sort of drifted. I was a lost soul. And then, I don't know. I think once I found a way of being able to, produce is the wrong word. Once I found a way that I could kind of make things, because that's what I couldn't find for a long time. I couldn't find, I don't know. I, Yeah, I couldn't find a language, I guess.
Yeah.
Also, I didn't have the confidence. But once I found both of those things, then anything that presents itself is an opportunity. So I just try and, yeah, I'm just, welcome to anything, really.
And I think that was something that really resonated in the sense that, like, kind of similar stats in the sense that I remember reading that you found school and education quite problematic in a way. I really, really struggled. I was undiagnosed ODHD at that point, and it was really, really difficult. I was an only child, living with her dad, which you can imagine on a council estate when you're nine in 1981. It just didn't really happen. And with that, so with bullying and things, and that's where I kind of found our local flyover. And that's what really drew me to you first, was when I used to go and hide within our flyover. That was my safe space. So when I then came across your work, and it was like, oh my goodness. And the more I dove in, and even as an adult, I didn't go to uni until I was in my early 30s as a mature student. And even then, it was really challenging. And even now, although I'm kind of finally finding my wee way of trying to get out there what's been inside me since forever, it's still very challenging. And I guess you said that, like, you have this deep interest. I mean, hauntology seeps through, but you have this deep interest with the ancient past and all. So I was just wondering where you kind of came to this thinking of linking motorway flyovers with Neolithic long barrows and stuff, so that other people could hear how you came into that.
Right. I mean, I came to it through, I mean, I thought about, oh God, what's the best way?
Sorry, that's quite a big question.
No, it's not. It's fine. I mean, I'll start further back. So I left school when I was like 15, 16. And, couldn't wait to get out of school. Just bad, sort of bad education, really. And I was a little scally, basically. I was, up to no good and all the rest of it. But for some reason, I suddenly needed to know about the founding, about the early civilization. I wanted to know what was the first major, city, really. And I mean, I think I had some idea that they were, born along the Nile. I'll get going.
Taking a while
to get my head back in. So anyway, I taught myself to a library when you could do a thing. You could just go to a public library, and I started reading about Babylon and Mesopotamia, and I can't say this with my accent.
No, that's all right.
Is obviously the first, the origin, the birth. So I don't know. So I always had a fascination with, like, I guess origins in some way, and how things are born and developed and built, and how they come into being, I guess, right? And the sort of social forces and the historical forces that kind of determine that, or the conditions. I guess I was interested in the kind of conditions of of creation, of kind of, like I say, of origins. And the bridge is quite a long and complicated. Do you want me to go into
it? Yeah, just because I know about it. There's going to be people listening who may never have even heard of that. So.
Okay. So, I don't know. I make a lot of work about. All right, come at this from several different directions. No worries. So I said earlier at the beginning, I found it difficult to find a language. So I went to art school. I went to art school late. I was a mature mm-hmm. student, but I was in my late 20s, and I found myself at art school, and I went to Newcastle Polytechnic, and this is in the late 80s, and in the late 1980s, initially, when I started in 1987, most of the students there, most of the art students there were kind of, sort of hippies from down south, really. You know, people from their home counties, hippies, crusties, as you would call them then. I don't know, crusties is pejorative, but anyway, so it's quite kind of like mellow, not particularly ambitious in any way, just more people who just wanted to make, you know, paint and sculpt, etc.
Mm-hmm.
And the only thing that I remember people reading at that time was like, you know, Tolkien mm-hmm. and Mervyn Peake. Mm. I remember being introduced to him when I was in my first year. And then we came back for the second year, and one of the tutors had been in New York and London, and he was quite, he fancied himself as quite a dynamic personality, and he introduced us to critical theory. So this is a kind of critical theory that was coming, that had come over from, well, this French theory that had kind of come across via America to London to Goldsmiths.
Yeah.
And had been instituted at Goldsmiths, and then kind of like slowly crept up the rest of the country. So by the time it got to Newcastle, it was like a couple of years later, really. So,
bit like the Neolithic.
Bit like the Neolithic. Things moved much slower in those days, you know. So suddenly we were introduced to all this very difficult, dense text. I had no experience of close reading. I had very little experience of reading, to be honest.
Mm.
You know, I didn't grow up in a household with books. So suddenly we were plunged into this, and you know, in some ways I found it very exciting. I wasn't dismissive. I was interested, but I found it incredibly difficult. And as a result of that kind of difficulty, I started to lose whatever, you know, meager confidence I had. In being an artist. I mean, I think artists are always troubled by doubt and confidence. And I just thought, I can't participate in this conversation because I just don't have the intellectual acuity. I don't have the capacity to be able to do this. I can't think my way through work. So I left art school thinking that was it for me. I wasn't going to be an artist. I was going to try and do something else instead. I was interested in fashion, and I was interested in, well, I kind of wanted to make music videos. That's what I really wanted to do, was make. I was always interested in music, I guess music and style. I mean, to be honest, I went to art school more in the hope that I'd find someone I could be in a band with, then to become an artist, which didn't happen. So anyway, I thought, I can't make art, but maybe I can find some other creative outlet, you know. So I moved down to London, and I ended up doing, I ran a stall on Portobello for a bit, selling clothes on Portobello. And then I went back to, I went to America. I lived in America. Right, now I'm going off on a real tangent.
Now go for it.
Point of this story is, I thought I couldn't make art because I didn't understand the discourse as it was then. And gradually, I kind of found my way back through kind of a series of, I don't know, accidents and also connections. I met people in the art world, started hanging around with them, and I began tentatively making this video that ended up being called Fiorucci Made Me Hardcore.
Yeah, fantastic.
And that, so that was the first piece I'd made. That was like 10 years after I left art school. I made that. And the reason I was able to make that was a number of things, one of which was access to cheap kind of domestic technology, i.e. I could, because basically Fiorucci Made Me Hardcore is a video that's made up of, I guess, archival footage, found footage, and I was able to take VCR, VHS tapes, and transcode them into a digital signal, right? And so then I could edit it, right?
Yeah.
And I was only able to do that because you could afford, but basically, this is late 90s, you could afford to buy like a, you know, you could afford to buy a desktop Mac and be able to do that. So that's one of the reasons I was able to do it. The other reason, the main reason, which is the sort of the reason I'm telling this story, is that I found a means of making work that I felt I kind of fully, not fully understood, but I'd experienced in some way. It came from a place that I felt attuned to. I thought, you know, I had the confidence to be able to speak about it because it was mine. I didn't feel in any way kind of alienated or lacking in kind of like an understanding. So that essentially gave me the confidence to be able to make something, because it was in my own compass. It was within my sort of locality, and that became a kind of sort of engine for making work. It's like, well, I can make work about what I knew, what I'd experienced, you know, the place I came from, kind of history that I'd lived through. You know, I left school in the early 80s in the Northwest. So, you know, I came out of school to a landscape, you know, devastated by Thatcher. So, you know, all of these things became a kind of, I'm trying to think of the right word. I had a good word then, it's just slipped away. You know, they became the archive. That's not the word I was looking for, but they became, you know, these are things I had to deal with as well in some ways. These are things I had to kind of, that I had metabolized, you know what I mean? They lived within me. And some of them lived within me in a very unhealthy way.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, a lot of my early work was always using loops. And that kind of came about because, I mean, I think loops are like part of like sample culture, yeah, which is what I was doing. But also, these were things that just went round and round and round with no seeming end, you know. So art gave me a means to kind of like exercise or kind of externalize toxicities. And that's how I started making it. So one of these loops was this frigging bridge, yeah, right? So that was a long way to that point. So the bridge. So when I was about 8 or 9, which is like, I'm always kind of slightly staggered by this. So I'm 8 or 9. I lived in a place called Eastham, which is on the Wirral, and sort of down the bottom of our road over uh-huh. a little brook was a motorway bridge. And it's a very weird motorway bridge in that it's a dual carriageway going over a B road, right, which normally it's the other way around.
All right, yeah.
This is, I kind of looked at it on the map. I think there's only about 3 or 4 around the country. It's quite an odd configuration. So we used to go and sit under this motorway bridge. You know, it had sloped it, underneath. It was slopes you could go up, and then at the top was like a little alcove. We used to go and sit in the alcove, and I don't know what I can't even really remember. I mean, I remember one mate, but I can't remember who the rest of us were. Can't remember what we did. I think we were too young to be smoking. But maybe we just like have sweets. We just go up there and kind of like pass the time. I don't think we were doing anything particularly naughty. And right, now I have to do this weird kind of like narrative rip, because something happened under the bridge. I don't know what happened under the bridge. I only know, or I only have a memory of much later. So this happened when I'm 8 or 9, and then we kind of like accelerate forward to when I'm about 19, 20, and this is when I've decided I wanted to go to art school. I was signing on, and someone said, you should look at going to art school. And I did. I looked into it, and I saw that I'd get a full grant and housing benefit and everything, and I would essentially be better off going to art school than I would be just signing on. So that's how it used to be. That's how people like me and other people went so easily into further education. The only barrier that time was a kind of like a sort of mistrust, sort of class mistrust and suspicion of kind of like student life, basically. You know, like none of my mates went to university. None of my family had been there. I hadn't even, you know, I hadn't considered it until much later, because it just wasn't open.
And it wasn't the sort of thing that, for people from our backgrounds, that it was just the,
yeah,
whereas for middle people, kids from middle thing. Class and yeah, upper class, exactly. It was just the normal trajectory, the perceived trajectory, wasn't yeah. it? For people like us, it was like, you know, you would finish your schooling, and then, you know, if you'd done quite well, you might do an A-level or something, but most would go into apprenticeships or, you know, so yeah. Yeah.
You know, I look now and think of like what would have happened if I'd have gone to sixth form, for example, and how differently things would have turned out. I think I would have loved sixth form college, you know. because when I got to, by the time I got to foundation, you know, I was totally smitten. But anyway, so I went there late, and I'd left school without any O levels or anything, so I had to resit everything to get in. I had to get my O levels, to get my A levels, blah blah blah. Do my English O level at Eastham Technical College, and the teacher asked us to write a composition about a memory or whatever. And I thought, I know, I'll write about that time I was under the motorway bridge and I saw a pixie or an elf or whatever this figure was. And so I started to write this story, and I've told this a lot of times, it sounds too rehearsed, but anyway, I'd up to that point, you know, you carry around these memories of your childhood. My sister got knocked over by a car. I fell through a plate glass window. I had Mrs. Sheard when I was in junior school. I saw a pixie under a bridge, right? These are the things I carried around with me from my childhood. And so I'm writing this story and I'm thinking, oh, what the fuck? What is this? You know, what is this memory? I hadn't considered it since then, really. And so there was this strange feeling. I remember being quite, you know, I wouldn't call it a terror, but there was a kind of a apprehension as I was writing this story out. It kind of, and that's the nearest I got to kind of a real memory of it. I just remember a fear came upon me as I was writing it. And then I wrote this story, and at the end of the story, I didn't believe it anymore. I'd dispelled it. I'd broken the whatever spell that was. But I had a kind of record of what I believed from my childhood, and essentially that what I thought had happened is this. I was sitting under the bridge and this figure, small figure had appeared at the end of the alcove, and it was dressed in a kind of a sort of ludicrous, cliched, comical way, like an elf or a dwarf. You know, I had a little hat with a bell on the end and you know, pointy shoes and all the rest of it. But I remember in writing the story that it was like it was conscious of its own. It was like it presented itself to me in a kind of ridiculous way as a kind of joke, or ironically, right? And not wasn't quite malevolent, but there was something kind of mocking, right? It mocked me, I would say, and and it enjoyed my discomfort. That's my kind of impression of that experience, that it just came to kind of, I don't know, it's not quite putting the frighteners on me, but it was to just sort of
made you feel uncomfortable.
Yeah. In a kind of like you shouldn't be here way.
Yeah.
I've just been watching these videos. There's these videos going around on TikTok at the moment, these
kids. I haven't dived into TikTok yet.
Not TikTok, scared. Sorry. It's on Twitter. I think they're on TikTok, but they get put up on Twitter.
Oh,
and it's these kids going around houses, and in one video they just walk into someone's house and pretend that they've been invited. So it's quite disturbing.
Yeah.
There's something of the same kind of slightly malicious joke in the same. It's like I was trespassing. And so they came to remind me that this wasn't a particularly welcoming place.
You'd slipped through a crack into their realm almost.
Yes, or in some way, yeah. So that's the story of the bridge. I don't know what I think now, to be honest. I still don't really know. It didn't Yeah, I'm completely ambiguous about what happened. Ambiguous, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm more kind of like, I mean, to be honest, the more fascinating thing for me is like, in this, or the thing I'm most interested in is really like childhood and imagination.
Yeah.
But I hesitate to call it imagination because I don't know if it's, because that suggests I just imagined it. But I think it's something to do with a kind of a perception that I might have had as a child that is not available to me now. It's that still kind of fascinates me about it. It hasn't led me on a path of like investigating like fairies or fairy folk or anything. I mean, I'm not uninterested in that, but you know, it's not, that's not where it's kind of, I'm more interested in a sort of, I don't know, I guess in a sort of Blakeian way, in a sort of William Blake kind of like you just said, this moment where you kind of a crack appears or some kind of access into some other, I don't know if it's even another realm, but I think it's just, like I say, it's another way, it's a door of perception your mind exactly. Just alights on something else or just finds a space for these things to kind of enter, you know, it becomes unblocked or whatever in some way, whatever way you want to kind of come to that and that.
Not too different to like how some people, when they talk about ghosts and things, and this is something I've been exploring through photography quite a lot recently, where you get people saying that ghosts are just signals from different yes. timelines that are seeping in, and okay, if we see them, that's because we've just somehow, whether we've seeped into their timeline, they've seeped into ours. And I've just been, well, I mean, I always spend a lot of time in tunnels and underpasses and stuff.
Right. Okay.
But recently, since the Elizabeth line has opened, and for people who around the world who don't know what that is, in London, it took about 4 or 5 years. It was a huge engineering feat, really. And this train track, it traverses from the county of Essex, which is in the east of sort of southeast of England, and it goes all the way along through London. It's primarily subterranean in London, and then it goes through past Heathrow Airport out beyond to another town called Reading. So I guess if you're around the world and you've ever watched the Office with Ricky Gervais, and where that company set in Slough, Reading is not too far away from Slough. But the thing is, these stations that have been created in London they are phenomenal. I mean, I have spent hours wandering through a lot of the different stations, and there is one particular walkway at the Liverpool Street station, and I did actually have to move the other week because station staff were coming down and watching me, because I don't know if they thought I was up to no good. Right. And I tried to explain to them what I was doing. They just gave me that same glazed look that I've received throughout my life when I've tried to explain to people what I'm doing. And so yeah, I've been sort of taking multiple images and fading people in and out, and then because I do all my stuff primarily on an iPhone, if you use the live capture, you can then get people that, if you in the still image, they're not there. But if you put it on live and then put it on long exposure, they suddenly come in and then fade out, which I was really tripping on. So then it was
right.
So yeah, I kind of wonder if things like the Fae or ghosts or these things are more kind of temporal slips, and we're open to them. Maybe younglings are more open to those things. I don't know.
Yeah, maybe.
It's just something I ponder upon.
Yeah.
But the thing that I do like with your work, and we have spoken about, where, so in the bridge as well. We've got the young people who are in tracksuits and so on. They've got their beatboxes and everything. And as I mentioned earlier, listeners, I kind of see them as perhaps are they the Fae who are just like presenting themselves in the 21st century in garb that might entice young, because they're always after younger people. They wanted to steal away. If you go into Irish folklore in particular, the Fae were always out to bewitch and steal away youngsters. And like, so whether or not, I mean, this is just how I see it. So maybe they're now in these tracksuits and things to do that. But the thing, and it shows how much it stuck with me, because I was walking on Brixton Road early morning a couple of weeks ago, and just near the footlocker, there were just this brand new, really expensive Nike high tops just there on the pavement, no one around. And I looked and I thought, yeah, they're quite my size as well. And I nearly went to, I thought, no, because what if it's the fairies and they just, because if you pick up, and this is the other thing in folklore with them, you pick up their, they leave their shoes, you pick them up and then that's it, they've got you. So I looked at them and then I thought, oh no, Leckey's coming in.
Right, damn, yeah, I love it. The fairies.
Well, I mean, if they're going to go anywhere, why not Brixton?
Why not Brixton? Exactly.
As we mentioned, the bridge is kind of, you kind of return to it again, but in a whole nother level now through virtual reality. And the really great Tremulations extended exhibition that's going on at Swedenborg House in London. And I was lucky enough to lose myself in your creation for it a couple of weeks ago. I'm off to hang out with Hilma Raff Clint in virtual reality next week, which I'm very excited about. How did you find that whole process of making, and then seeing, obviously you engaged with the bridge as a child physically. What's it like now engaging with it and its kind of inhabitants through the virtual?
All right, that's a good question. Well, in 2019, I had a show at Tate Britain.
You did?
And we reconstructed the actual motorway bridge.
It was fantastic.
In the space, it was almost to scale. And at the time I was doing that show, there's a company called Acute who make, they want to kind of make art or get artists to make VR works. And they'd approached me and said, do you want to make a VR work? And I said, well, I'm doing this piece at the Tate about a bridge, and I think that'd work as a VR piece. So like I say, this is 2019, and there was even talk of it being part of the exhibition at the Tate. It didn't happen because VR is quite slow to make. But then we thought it'd come out a bit after, but then the pandemic hit. And so that piece has been delayed since then, really. So I went back myself to sort of revisit it when they made the VR. But I mean, it's kind of, I don't, I always remember I made this video a while ago called Dream English Kid, and I was sort of trying to there was a conceit that I could find online enough material to kind of refashion my memories, right? I could tell my autobiography or like auto fiction or whatever through the archives of the internet, right? The vast archives of the internet.
Yeah.
And there's one sort of chapter in that video where I attempted to, again, one of these kind of loops from childhood when a I don't know if you did the same. Did you have aunties when you grew up who were just your mum's mate or your dad? Yeah.
Oh, no. Trust me. There are aunties. Okay. There are uncles.
I had an auntie Brenda. And auntie Brenda was like my mum's kind of posh mate who did ballroom dancing. And and she was like a real 60s. I'm going to say Dolly Bird, but in the, because that was, you know.
Yeah. Glam, but they were like, because when you go down the working men's club on a Friday, Saturday night, and the wives came out and they were like, in their finery. You know,
back-combed hair and false eyelashes and all the rest of that, right?
Yeah.
So Brenda was like that. And I used to, you know, they'd go and have parties or whatever, or just go around there for a drink, and they put me upstairs in the bedroom, right?
Yeah. With the coats
and all that. Yeah, exactly. So I was in the bedroom one night while my mum and dad were downstairs and all the rest. And Brenda came upstairs. I'm about 7 or 8 at this time. And she came upstairs and, I don't know, she changed the dress. She wanted to get changed. And it's always, you know, it was basically my first kind of like, sexual encounter would be the wrong word, but you know, it's the first kind of sexual awakening or whatever, right?
Yeah.
And you know, it's kind of in that sense it's kind of stuck with me in a very kind of fetishistic way, right?
Yeah.
It sort of developed a lot of fetishistic tastes from that encounter, right? And I thought when I'm making this autobiography that, you know, that's a kind of key moment. I was like, how am I going to kind of remake this or fashion this? So I ended up with this video from a Carry On film.
Yeah.
And it's got, oh my God, I've forgotten her name.
It's your woman who passed away a couple of years.
Yeah, yeah.
I can't think of her name.
No, I can't either. That's really sad that I can't remember her name.
Yeah. She was in lots of them though, wasn't she?
She was in lots of the Carry On films.
Yeah.
And anyway, I sort of made this video with her, sort of rotoscoping her out of this clip of a Carry On film. And she stood in as a substitute for this auntie. And basically the way it constructed, I thought it was so elaborate the way I put it together. I thought, well, this will kind of, you know, this will provide some kind of insight or kind of, if not an insight, at least I've kind of got it out of my system, so to speak. It's like, I sort of rid myself of it in some way, and as I was finishing it, I came across this quote from Freud, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you know, when I was at art school, there was an expectation to read Freud, which I never did, and I should have, perhaps, because Freud talks about this idea of like a screen memory. So he says, traumas or kind of origin story you have, and you have this kind of like very fixed, like a narrative about what happened, this occurrence. Yeah. It's like, that's not what happened. What your mind has kind of created, your unconscious has created this kind of like, you know, image that prevents you from knowing the kind of reality, essentially, right?
Yeah.
Like it's like, it's not a false memory, but it's like it kind of has elements of what the truth is, but it's like a screen. It's basically a screen that prevents you seeing behind it. And I was like, oh, all of this was for nothing then. It reveals nothing. All I've done is remade the screen, which I kind of liked in some ways, but it's so anyway, that the point of that story is to say that in all these kind of attempts to kind of, like I say, rid myself or exercise these things or at least have some kind of like greater consciousness of what happens, it never works.
No,
it's a failed enterprise, And the only way it succeeds is in a kind of fuel for me to make something, which ultimately is enough. But I have to delude myself that it's going to result in some kind of a knowledge, some kind of gnosis. But I know that it doesn't. I know deep down that it doesn't. I don't know if I'll do it again.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if I'll make that kind of work again, because I no longer believe in its kind of like potential healing properties.
Yeah.
It's just like picking at a scab, really. But, you know, which could be quite enjoyable, right?
Well, as a kid, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hence why I've got scars all over my leg.
Exactly, yeah.
I was a kid.
So, so I at the end of the bridge thing, it's like, I don't know, I just sort of created this or there. I just made it even more a greater edifice, you know, an even bigger entity. It just got bigger. I guess in some way I exhausted it. I guess that's the best thing you can say. I kind of exhausted it. And now I don't have to think about it. So
yeah.
So maybe, but there's no real resolution or no insight, except
maybe
that.
There's not meant to be.
Maybe there's not meant to be. There you go. Yeah. Maybe there's not meant to be. It's just a kind of, oh good. I can kind of almost forget it, except it's always there now to remind me.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I must admit, it was only my second experience of virtual reality.
Okay.
The first one was when Björk had the exhibition at Somerset House around 2015, 16.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And that was phenomenal. But a lot of it was the experience, although you're getting 360s and all, it was still quite, how do I explain it? Describe it, stationary in a sense that with your work now, I know this is 5-6 years on from that, and technology is moving at such a rapid rate that to be literally within the space of your bridge and being stood next to those kids in their tracksuit and was just phenomenal for me. But the thing that really got me is that trying to tell my brain, so for listeners, with this VR experience now, you can stand perfectly still or wander around a wee bit. I was in a room on my own.
All right.
And luckily the very nice chap at Swedenborg House moved all the chairs out of the way for me.
Okay.
And you're walking through and you can see every aspect of this amazing landscape. And there's at one point in the experience, you start to descend and the flyover starts to meld into, does it go Lanyon Coit and then into what looks like West Kennet, Longbarrow? I can't remember.
West Kennet, yeah.
Well, I've had some very strange experiences there. And the thing that really got me, I'm looking at the floor and watching myself descend, but I couldn't move forward. I couldn't physically move my feet because I thought I'm going to fall over this.
Okay, yeah.
And I'm trying to tell my brain, move my feet, which was just fantastic and scary. And I was really annoyed at myself. But so I'm in this digital landscape, and something that I'm pondering a lot upon, and I'm looking to maybe expand into a full-on research project is like through future ghosts. I'm really intrigued by digital landscapes at the moment and the fact that, you know, we are people with their online presence. We're just adding to these kind of middens minute by minute, hour by hour. We're creating these sort of digital stratigraphies. And I'm kind of obsessing on the fact that I think archaeologists in the future may well not entirely abandon terrestrial excavation, but that to explore peoples of the late 20th, the 21st centuries beyond, they're just going to go purely for these digital
right
landscapes. And obviously, I guess most people are thinking that they just think in terms of social media and so forth, and these online shopping and so forth, which are all really important. But the thing that's really intriguing me is when I see artworks like The Bridge in VR and Björk's work and all the other myriad works that are now being created, especially within VR at the moment. My friend Ruben Froh, his landscapes within Tokyo are just absolutely phenomenal. And he's just done this really amazing piece with this underpass.
All right.
So I'm kind of wondering, if this does turn out to be the case, how are the archaeologists of the future, are they going to look at these digital creations and perhaps give them more credence than the terrestrial ones that inspired them?
Mm.
And just stuff like this. I mean, it's all very loose, but I'm just really intrigued by it.
Oh, and okay.
And also seeing social media at the moment as almost people legacy building, and where we had thousands of years ago, so with Ur and the Pharaonic period in Egypt and beyond that, people building their legacies within sort of physical architecture, we've now got people kind of building their legacies through Instagram and so forth, these, what do you call them, influencers and so forth.
Yeah.
Because also we don't know if those are their real lives or if they're just... And it's something that I'm kind of really curious about. I just wondered if you've ever pondered upon anything like that, or if not, what your thoughts might kind of be.
The first thought is, you know, I've always... I'm a child of the analog era, right? And then sort of in my middle age, it's like I had to adapt to the digital, and so a lot of the work I make, but also just what I think about is that threshold, right? Is that kind of cusp. Part of the kind of fascination, or the sort of sublime of the internet, this idea of the internet as a kind of like hyper object, this sort of vast repository, is that it was it's limitless, right? It's just limitless space. And then only last week, on Twitter, a lot of people were talking about the fact that Google, who now own YouTube, right?
Yeah.
Are going to shut down dormant YouTube sites.
Yeah, and Twitter are also going to, they're going to turn off dormant sites on there as well.
Yeah. And I do a radio station on NTS, and I would say, you know, half of the kind of materials I get, I probably find on these kind of like semi-dormant or dormant YouTube sites, you know, that haven't been uploaded for, you know, a decade or five years. So in terms of music, you're going to lose this enormous, you know, that's enormous, right? That's a lot of historically interesting and brilliant music that essentially had this brief period where it came to light again. You know, it might be made in a lot of the stuff I find is from the sort of early 70s or sort of.
Yeah.
I'd, fascinated by that period, and you know, a lot of records were made in the early 70s, and subsequently became obscure almost immediately. And now through YouTube and that, these people have been archiving them, and that's all going to go.
Mm.
If this is true, so. So now you're thinking. Now I'm thinking about. I'm thinking about these things differently. I'm thinking about that. You know, this idea of like you say, an archaeology or a kind of, you know, this sort of strata of internet. I mean, you know, Tumblr's gone.
Yeah.
MySpace is gone. All these things that you kind of that accumulated and built the internet. You know, that unless someone's archive them, they just disappear, you know. And memories, you know, whole memories of people, whole kind of experiences and instances of them being here on this planet.
Yeah,
there's nothing. it's just washed away. So I don't know. I feel a bit different about things now. About those, because I was always kind of, you know, there's a kind of entropy built into the internet, right? So things die off, but there's still, you know, I could think of myself in that sense as like an archaeologist, yeah. Right? I go and find these dead things. And resuscitate them, right? You know, bring them to light. So I don't know. I mean, to say I'm in shock would be a bit too much hyperbole, but I'm sort of. It's definitely changed my thinking about the about what those archives are. I never thought that they could so easily be dismissed.
It's wiped out. And it's interesting, isn't it, that well, in the tech giants, in one instance, they're quite happy to, like you say, just basically wipe out these huge swathes of.
Yeah.
We could talk about it in culture, but as you said, of people, of lived experiences through whether it's music, the creation of that music, the joy it brought to people at the contemporaneous time, but then moving forward. Exactly. And that can be applied to all sorts of things. And also with Twitter accounts, a lot of those accounts that are there are of people who have sadly passed over. And I guess for loved ones, but if these people were well known, it's a way to maintain contact with them. And that's gone. But then on the next hand, they'll be, you know, doing press releases about how they're creating technology that will enable us to reconnect with people who have died. I was reading something yesterday. Right. Was it yesterday, the day before? I think he was saying it kind of tongue in cheek, but Tom Hanks, the actor, saying about AI, basically employing AI so that whilst he's still alive, he will sort of lay down, I suppose, various characters. Well, I didn't read too deeply into it, that then could be used to make films after he's died. And there's companies going, this is great and amazing. It's like, well, you can't decide what gets to stay and what, you shouldn't be able to decide what gets to stay and what doesn't. It's almost like there's a kind of a God complex thing going on.
Yeah, well, definitely it becomes, you know, I think with all those sites were, you know, Tumblr, yeah. MySpace, you know, they were essentially accessible and available to everyone, right? And they were
really formative.
That was the beauty of the, you know, early internet, wasn't it? It was that anyone could post, anyone could put anything up. And now, you know, you're like you said, you're moving towards something that's more like someone with the fame and kind of wealth of someone like Tom Hanks will go on to be immortal, while everyone else, you know, loses their, you know, departed loved ones' Twitter account, you know. So it's very divisive.
If you're listening to this via the website, then you know the website address. If you're watching it via YouTube, the website is liminalworlds.org. It's all completely free access. I want to try and keep it that way for as long as possible. We do have a Ko-fi page, ko-fi.com/liminalworlds. If you like what you hear, if you are in a position to bung some money that way, whether it's a one-off or a small monthly donation, that's grand. But I am fully aware that everyone is really struggling at the moment. So I just want to say thank you very much, Mark Leckey. It's been a pleasure.
Oh, thank you, Beth. That was fun. Yeah, no, nice to finally meet you.
Thank you, everyone, for listening. And we'll see you next time. But until then, take care, be safe, and goodbye.
Thank you.
Bye.